So this video appears to be cursed. You see, when I was recording the first half of it, basically, I got a message popping up on my camera that said that the card was not readable. What I did not realize is that that basically meant that everything that I had recorded up to that point was not being saved. And so when I went to edit, the first part wasn't there. So now I have to reshoot the first part of it. And I'm really getting close to running out of time. So, with that being said, let's go ahead and roll the thing. Hey guys, Sean here. So the original plan for this week was to do number 3 or 4, whatever it is, of my All of Disneyland in 2018 video series, but something happened earlier in this week that made me end up having to push a video that I've been meaning to do for quite some time now. In fact, ever since I got the whiteboard that I write ideas on, it's been at the top of that board and I just haven't gotten around to it. Well, something happened earlier this week that has made me move that up to this week, so the Disneyland video will be next week. Now with that being said, let's talk about childhood heroes. Now my childhood hero from when I was in grade school, from what I can remember, was a television character that had a very important job. You know, lives depended on the decisions that he made, and it was a very high pressure job, but the way that he approached it was basically in a childlike sort of manner. He really wanted to have fun all the time, and he really lightened the mood, and yet he still had everyone respect him because they saw that the way that he did things, even though we're childish and goofy and all that, still really helped get to the resolution of the matter at hand. And I am, of course, talking about Judge Harold T. Stone on Night Court. Night Court is my most favorite sitcom of all time. How much so? Well, I have all the DVDs right here, and these are not easy to come by. How much so? Well, let's see. The first 3 seasons were released in stores, so you could go into like Best Buy or Target and buy them, but apparently they didn't sell very well to the point where you couldn't even buy the remainder of the DVDs, and I was very upset about that. But then eventually, the Warner Archive ended up putting up the remainder seasons on DVD, and the way that the Warner Archive works is that they don't have warehouses full of these, they just, when someone orders it, then they print it and send it to you. The quality, not necessarily the best, but at least it's the show on DVD. So let's talk a little bit about Night Court and its creation. It ran from January 4th, 1984 to May 31st, 1992. It was created by Reinhold Wege, who was a producer and writer on Barney Miller. Now, after working on Barney Miller, Reinhold Wege had been trying to get some pilots made. He had 5 pilots that he had written and sent out, and they just didn't end up getting made until one day NBC approached him and was like, "We saw the work that you did on a show, what was it? It was called Park Place, which was about illegal aid." And actually, during the time that he was working on that show, he went to night courts around New York City to basically learn about night courts and stuff like that. And so NBC approached him and was like, "We have an idea for a show. We have one word for you. It is court." And so he was like, "Well, I spent all this time in these night courts around New York City, so let's go ahead and make a show about a night court." So he knew the main character of the show should be the judge, but he didn't want it to be your typical authoritative stick-in-the-mud, just what you would expect from a judge around that time of television. So he created this character, Harold T. Stone, who was obsessed with the 40s, always wore a fedora and crazy ties in his off time, and was obsessed with Mel Torme, and was a magician, and a prankster, and just all-around silly person who would lighten the mood in tough situations. Now, ironically, he created this character, but he hadn't been watching Cheers for the last 2 years, because on October 21st, 1982, this character, Harry the Hat, made his first appearance.
Hey, Coach, how about a beer?
Forget it, Harry. And now Sam says I can't serve you anymore, you're a flim flam.
Oh, no, it ain't for me. I'm expecting a friend.
A friend?
Yeah, he asked me to order it for him. He did. In fact, he wrote it down. One beer.
Now, wait a minute. Wait. One minute, Harry. Let me see that. Yeah, one beer. Harry, I just had to make sure.
Okay.
That'll be $1.
$1. Let's see. Gosh, I thought I had a dollar. Well, I got a 10. You got change?
Absolutely. There you go. 5 and 4 ones.
Oh, Harry. Look at this. I have $1 after all. I don't need the change, Coach. Why don't you give me my 10 back?
Right. Right. There you go.
There you go. Coach, I don't want to carry around all these bills. Listen, give me a 20 for the whole thing. What do you say?
You got it.
Nobody move.
Coach, don't you see what he's doing? I mean, he's shortchanging you.
Oh, no. Sam, he's outsmarted me before, but not this time. No way. Believe me.
Coach, how much money are you giving him?
$20.
How much is he giving you?
Oh, darn you, Harry.
Sam, I'm just trying to keep in practice. Coach, I tell you what. I'll give you a $30 bill. We'll call it even, okay?
What do you think, Sam?
There's no such thing as a $30 bill,
you
Coach.
You
want
to bet?
Bar, Harry. Come on.
Wait a minute. You owe me $10. What is this, a clip joint?
I'm sorry. Here, now go on.
You know, Sam, you got the wrong idea about me.
No, I really don't. Now, Harry, you got 10 seconds to get out of my bar and give me back my watch, Harry.
Just trying to help you guys out. I mean, if you want to upgrade a little bit, I'm just saying.
Harry the Hat was played by comedian and magician Harry Anderson, and Harry the Hat is essentially Harry Anderson. He is who he was at that time. And when he saw the casting notice for Night Court, he was like, this character is me. Did this guy write this part for me? So when he went and auditioned for it, Reinhold Weggie, when he saw Harry Anderson, he was like, I was not expecting to find not only the perfect person for this character, but finding basically the actual character. And he hadn't had any writers yet or directors or anything lined up, and he had already found his star. And so that's something that, like, never happens in Hollywood. And the fact that it actually happened, he wrote this character. He named him Harry. He was a magician and loved the 40s and wore fedoras all the time. And he had no idea who Harry Anderson was when he wrote this character. And yet, he basically wrote Harry Anderson if he were a judge. So now he had his central judge character, but he needed the rest. So the interesting thing about the Night Court cast is that there's only three characters that were in every single season. There is, of course, Judge Harold T. Stone, and then there was the tall, menacing-looking bailiff, Bull Shannon, played by Richard Mull, who actually, once you got to know him, had a heart of gold. And then there was the brash, just egotistical, disgusting district attorney, Dan Fielding, played by John Larroquette. As a side note, an interesting thing about John Larroquette and Harry Anderson that not a lot of people realize is that they are both really tall as well. They were both 6'4". But people didn't really notice it because for 9 seasons, they were standing next to Richard Mull, who was 6'8", and made them look much shorter than they actually are, but they too are rather tall men. In fact, I think the show has the record for having the tallest cast in television history or something like that. So now let's talk about the other roles around the court. So first off, there is the court clerk. In the first season, it was Lana Wagner, played by Karen Austin. She was, of course, replaced in the second season by Mac Robinson, who was played by Charles Robinson, because Reinhold Weggie has this thing where he likes to use parts of the actor's actual name to name the character for some reason, so you will see that a lot on this list. And of course, Mac was the court clerk for the remainder of the show. So now let's talk about the bailiffs. So as I said, Richard Mole played Bull Shannon for every single episode, and he was, you know, the tall, menacing looking guy, though when you got to know him, he wasn't like that at all, so they thought it'd be funny to have next to him, you know, a smaller, demure, older woman who was the opposite of that, was very brash and just not what you would expect. So the role was actually written for Selma Diamond, who was a well-known comedy writer at the time. She actually wrote for Your Show of Shows. I believe she was the only female writer for Your Show of Shows. And Reinhold Weggie wrote the role specifically for her. In fact, her name was Selma Hacker. Of course, going back to what I was saying before about him using the name of the actor for the character. And so she was the second bailiff for the first two seasons until she passed away at the end of the second season. So then they cast Florence Halep, who played Florence Kleiner, again, names, and she was also a older, small woman and had a unique, gravelly sounding voice like Selma Diamond did, and she was kind of basically the same character. And then at the end of the third season, she passed away as well. And so for the fourth season, I don't know that this is actually the case, but I'm just assuming that they were like, well, we really like having the opposite of Bull, so... But instead of doing the you know, frail-looking older woman, let's do something different than that. And it wouldn't have been fair to do it a third time. It wouldn't have been fair to Selma and Flo to do that a third time. And so they hired Marcia Warfield to play Roz Russell. Marcia Warfield, of course, being a strong, no-nonsense black woman that was just the polar opposite of Bull. And she was the second bailiff from the fourth season to the end of the series. And then we have the public defenders. Now, first off, there was Sheila Gardner, played by Gail Strickland, and she was only in the pilot episode. For the remainder of the first season was Liz Williams, played by Paula Kelly. She was replaced in the second season by Billy Young, who was played by Ellen Foley. Now, there was one episode in the second season where Billy wasn't on it. I don't know the reason why she wasn't on it, but they had a fill-in public defender who was Christine Sullivan, played by Marky Post. And of course, Marky Post would go on into the third season to take that role, and she was the public defender for the remainder of the series. So really, it wasn't until the fourth season that the final cast was solidified until the end of the series. So now we've talked about the cast of characters and all that, but let's quickly talk about what the show was about. Because in the pilot episode, there is something that is kind of a catalyst for the entire series. When the pilot episode starts, all of the characters other than Harry, so we got Dan and Bull and Sheila and Lana and Selma, are talking about their new judge showing up because they're getting a new judge that day. And they're all freaking out about it because who's the judge gonna be? What's gonna happen? And so at one point when they're talking, this young looking man walks in carrying a box of stuff and they're all just like dismissive of him and all that. And of course it turns out that that is their new judge, Harold T. Stone. And he is the youngest judge in New York history. Of course he's like 32, so it's not like he's in his 20s or something like that, but still, 32 is young to be a judge. And so that's kind of the plot of the first episode, is them dealing with this young, crazy judge and his antics and what are they going to do about it, and then understanding that his methods may be crazy, but in the end, they are fair and just. And then at one point they're gonna take a recess and he asks, does anyone have any questions? And this happens.
Just what? How? How did you get appointed to the bench?
You know, Dan, that's a funny story. It was the mayor's last day in office and it was a Sunday. And my name was at the bottom of a list of 1,000 candidates. So they start calling folks starting at the top of the list. But you see, it's Sunday, so no one's home. So they keep calling down the list, name by name. No one answers. Finally, they get down to the bottom of the list, and voila.
You mean you were were appointed a judge because...
I was home. There'll be a 10-minute recess. Pass it on.
Now, according to Reinhold Weihe, this is slightly based in reality because there was some point before this where he had heard a story of the outgoing either mayor of or governor. It was either the mayor of Los Angeles or the governor of California, whichever one of them appoints judges. On his last day, he appointed just anyone who was available to appoint to judgeship in order to basically screw over the incoming mayor or governor, whichever it was. Because why would politicians be any different back then than they are now? And so the show ran for 9 seasons. It was on Thursday nights. On Thursday nights, there was The Cosby Show and Family Ties and Cheers and then Night Court. It basically started must-see TV before they came up with the term must-see TV. And to this day, it is still my most favorite sitcom of all time. I haven't watched all of the DVDs yet. I've only made it up to season 6. I'm like halfway through season 6. But like every episode, there's something in each one that just makes me laugh every single time. Even though I've probably seen most of these hundreds of times from when they were in syndication. And it just makes me sad that it's not on any sort of streaming service. Like, it's not on Hulu, it's not on Netflix. Like, you had to buy the DVDs directly from Warner Brothers. And that just makes me sad that there's not more people that are able to watch this amazing show. So, why did I feel the need that I had to do this video on Night Court this week instead of doing the video that I had originally planned? Well, as you probably know, earlier this week, Harry Anderson passed away. After Night Court ended, he ended up going over to CBS and starring in Dave's World, where he played famous column writer Dave Barry, and that show lasted for 4 seasons until 1997. And then after that, he just kind of left show business and left the limelight. There was, however, one episode of 30 Rock where they had sort of a quasi-Night Court reunion, and they didn't get all of the cast, but they got most of them. And that was kind of it. That was the last time anyone really saw Harry Anderson in the public eye. So earlier this week, when he passed away, it was kind of shocking to everybody because it's like, wow, we really haven't seen him for a long time. And that kind of sucks that we never will now ever again. It's kind of a weird thing when actors who are in the public eye just all the time eventually just retire and just disappear from the face of the earth. It's like Rick Moranis. Rick Moranis, he retired to raise his kids, and he hasn't been in anything for like 15 years now. But there's always the hope that once they've completed whatever it is that they retired for, like with Rick Moranis and raising his kids, like now that his kids are grown, maybe he'll come back to acting. And it was the same with Gene Wilder after Gilda Radner died, and he just kind of went away from acting. There was always the hope that maybe he would come back and do more, but sometimes it just never happens. They stay out of the limelight for whatever the reason is to them, which, you know, it's perfectly understandable if that's what they want, but it's sad when that happens. I would have at least liked to hear Harry Anderson doing, you know, podcast circuits or something. Like, I would have loved hearing him on Chris Hardwick's podcast or something like that. But now that will never happen. And so I guess you could say that a part of my childhood died this week, because as I said, he was, at least from what I can remember, my childhood hero when I was in grade school. I would like to think that I have brought what I learned from watching him as a child into my adult life, if you could call it an adult life, and that just because things might be serious, you can still have fun, and it sometimes helps to have fun in serious situations. Of course, the fact that I work at a place that really isn't serious, isn't life-altering, isn't any of those things, probably isn't even respected in some points it doesn't really matter as much. But I'd like to think that if I was in a job like that, that I would still have the same sort of demeanor to the detriment of my coworkers. But that's going to do it for this week's video, as I am greatly running out of time, as I need to get this edited and thrown up in the next 6.5 hours, so that'll be fun. Let me know down in the comments below who your childhood heroes were, and if you still consider them heroes, and if they're still with us today, if you still look up to them, and, you know, just any sort of general childhood hero conversation you may want to have. I always respond to the comments when they are posted. And while you're down there, if you like this video, go ahead and hit the like button. And if you'd like to see more of the crazy crap that goes on around here, go ahead and hit the subscribe button. And if you'd like to help support the crazy crap that goes on around here, go ahead and hit up my Patreon. And with that, have a good however long it is until you watch my next video.